they're going to pump you with information to get you scared, depending on where you're currently at financially and stuff like that, okay? I guarantee you that's going to happen in the next 12 to 24 months. Hey, Jeff Koga here, and welcome to Jeff Koga Live. All right, so in this episode of Jeff Koga Live, I want to talk about why 99% of millennials are not ready for the next recession. Now, why did I decide to create this episode? It's this. Is one, I'm in a generation called the Millennials, right? I was born 1985, all right? Mid-80s baby. And luckily, or you can call it a blessing in disguise. At that time when it happened, I didn't think that it was a blessing, but I was impacted by the last recession of 2008. Now, why am I talking about the next recession? Here's a disclaimer on this, okay? Number one, no one really knows when the next recession is gonna be, all right? And I'll tell you this right now, and I've done some research, so you can do it yourself, but highly recommend for you to just listen and pay attention to what I'm talking about here, okay? Now, the next, you know, I want to say 12 to 24 months, you're going to hear a lot from the news, I guarantee you, okay, about is the bubble going to pop, okay? They're going to talk about either the stock market bubble or the real estate bubble, all right? Why is it? Because it's hot right now. So the news is going to pump you with a lot of information and make you feel exactly either one, to get really, really emotional and excited about something, and or they're going to pump you with information to get you scared, depending on where you're currently at financially and stuff like that, okay? I guarantee you that's going to happen in the next 12 to 24 months. Now, if anyone remembers, you're in an older generation, you remember what happened in 2005, 2006. Yeah, the media got really, really hot, okay? A lot of articles, a lot of blogs at that time that came up, okay? And they talked about this. But I now, as we just had a presidential election and you heard about fake news and things like that, right? You're going to see a lot more of this either fear-mongering and or they're going to sell you kind of the pie-in-the-sky stuff on why the economy is going to do so well, all right? Now, I don't know exactly what's going to happen. I really don't, because who knows, you know, as you listen to this podcast recording, who knows? What if we go to war or something like that? War is really bad, right? Okay. But one thing is for certain is that there's currently right now, businesses are doing really, really well, as well as the stock market's doing really, really well. And then let's talk about another one, which I'm very familiar with, which is the real estate market is doing really, really well. All right. Now, those three things are doing exceptionally well. And I'm going to break down kind of all three, all right, on this is my humble opinion of it, and why I'm going to explain why millennials aren't ready for when the next recession happens, okay? And I'm using that loosely, okay? Because if you understand market cycles, you understand where we're currently at, then if you are a millennial listening to this, okay, it can change that course of your entire life, in my humble opinion, all right? So let's talk about just businesses in general, all right? One thing that you need to pay attention to is what the Trump administration is going to do, taxes for business owners, all right? I'm talking about for corporations, all right? Because he is trying to change the tax law on how corporations are going to be taxed. Now, keep in mind, payroll taxes are historically low and companies pay a lot less than taxes. Why is it? Because we expense a lot of stuff off versus if you are a W-2 employee, okay? And if you're a W-2 employee, meaning that you have a 9-to-5 job and you're getting a paycheck every single month, you're paying probably the highest amount of taxes than anyone in this country, okay? Especially if you're like middle class America or whatever, right? Meaning like, hey, you're making money from a good salary job, you're paying a lot of taxes versus people that are business owners are able to expense a lot of things off. Why is because when they get the revenue from their business, then they can write it off as expenses. Now, here's a prime example of this from a conversation I just had this past week with a friend of mine, and he just, you know, hits me up on Facebook and says, hey, you know what, you know, I got an update for you. And I was like, okay, what's up? And then I just gave my number and he calls me up, and we got in a conversation about student loans. Now you might say, well, student loans, what does that got to do with anything? Is that he is a business owner, he is an entrepreneur. Now he hits me up and he at one time was in actual school for pharmacy. All right, so he was trying to become a doctor, okay? And so he's carrying around $200,000 in debt from the student loan. Now, he never finished. Why? It's because he decided to just go full-blown with real estate. Okay, so he hits me up and says, man, I just pulled up my credit and it skyrocketed over 715 on my FICO. And I'm starting to get a lot of credit card offers, man. And he's all like, and then I pulled up my credit report and it didn't even show up on the credit report. Do you know anything? What's up with that? And then I was just like, so tell me a little bit more. And he hasn't been paying his student loan. Why? He just couldn't at that time when he was in default, okay? Now, I'm not telling you to say, hey, don't pay your student loan, okay? But I'm giving you a scenario where there's our millions and millions of millennials who have a high amount of student loan debt. And because of the choices that they made in their career jobs, some of you guys and gals can't actually pay their student loans, all right? But this individual pivoted and went into real estate and started their business. And, you know, he said he's gonna take care of his obligation now because his business is doing well, but he was just shocked in the fact that his credit score jumped up. And then I explained to him, I said, look, man, if you're paying attention to what's happening, you see my post recently, I talked about this. And he's like, yeah, man, I read up on the real estate side where Fannie Mae made adjustments in not including student loans on when it comes to calculating for mortgage loans. And he was like, yeah, I read up on that. And he says, did you hear about the other stuff that's going on? And I was like, no. And I was like, you hear about the FICO score? They made adjustment in their algorithm on how they actually score credit scores. And it literally brought up FICO scores for people across the board, anywhere between, on the low end, anywhere between 20 to 30 points, all the way up to even 50 to 100 points on their FICO score. Right now, you got to start wondering, why are they doing that? Well, I'm a firm believer that the powers that be is looking to keep on continuously inflate the real estate market by having people buy and borrow, because the biggest fear in the economy is not inflation, okay? If you know anything about how economy works, the talk that you're gonna hear on CNBC, okay, CNN Money, or any type of talk show is you're gonna hear people talking about runaway inflation. And the truth is that that's not gonna happen. Why? Is because we have the Federal Reserve, okay? And the Federal Reserve can literally print money out of thin air. And the Federal Reserve, the chairmen's that currently right now, like Janet Yellen, right? Ben Bernanke, Alan Greenspan, Paul Volcker, right? All of these people have seen the devastation of what happens when a Federal Reserve does not intervene with that economy. Right, just like Japan, for example, right? When Japan's economy popped, the federal government, the Bank of Japan, which is considered the Federal Reserve of Japan, did not intervene. And because they did not intervene, they stayed in a recession for over 10 plus years, all right? Some people claim it's 10, some people claim it's 15. But regardless of whatever you want to call it, there's a nickname for it called the 10-year recession. The lost decade, because everything contracted. And Alan Greenspan knows about this, you know, Ben Bernanke knows about this, right? And I'm sure Janet Yellen, our current Federal Reserve Chairman, knows about this, right? And the other banks around the world knows about this, right? Let's call it the francs, right? Let's call it the New Zealand dollar, right? Australian dollars. All of these central banks know about this. So what do? They keep on printing money. It's a global expansion of currency, right? So again, I'm giving you a higher level on this, but let me bring this down because I feel like I'm just giving you like way too much information on this, is this. The millennial generation currently right now are on the sideline, and with that conversation, just like I said, is that people are trying to get people to spend money, because when you spend money, that money exchanges and it goes back into the economy and someone makes money. It's someone's salary, right? When you spend a dollar, buy it somewhere else, that dollar goes in and becomes someone's money, right? Like the business owner or the person who works there, okay? So here's the reason why millennials are not ready for the recession. Number one, most of the individual aren't paying attention to market cycles, and because of that, you're going to lose a big opportunity to take advantage of certain market cycles, okay? Now, I'm a firm believer that we're gonna probably see a stock market correction versus a real estate correction first. All right, now here's the reason why. We just hit, what, 21,000 in Dow, on the Dow, right? So there's more money in the economy and people are really bullish about it, but the stock market is a paper asset. So the paper asset, I'm a firm believer, is a lot easier for people to get spooked and start pulling out money. All right, versus like real estate, it's a little bit more difficult to pull out money. Why? Is because you have to actually sell the hard asset. All right? So regardless of whichever one, if it does correct, I don't think we're gonna see a crash per se, okay? We may see it in the equities market. I don't know when, but definitely we're gonna see it. And I believe I saw Robert Scheller, okay, with the Scheller Index, okay, talking about how the PE ratio for the S&P 500 is at 2005 levels, okay? So he was saying, hey, you know what? It could possibly go down like 2008, 2009, or it can actually go up, you know, almost double what we're currently at, what it did in the dot-com bubble days of 1999. All right, so let me talk about this first off. If you wanna understand market cycles, and if you don't understand market cycles, here's what you can do to figure out who you should listen to, right? On Google, go into Google and type in whatever it is. Real estate crash, stock market crash, and then go to the advanced section, which is there's like a gear section in Google, okay? And use the advanced Google search query and change the date and then put it in like anywhere from, if it's a real estate, put in any articles that were published between 2005 to 2007, all right? And put that in there, real estate prediction. Okay, and what you'll start finding is individuals who made prediction of the real estate market. And what you'll discover is this: Warren Buffett did not call for a crash until 2006, okay? And that's when Charlie Munger and Warren Buffett, and Charlie Munger is Warren Buffett's business partner, came out and says, hey, real estate is overpriced, be careful, all right? Has Warren Buffett said that? No, not yet. Now, the more I start looking at the market, okay, I believe Warren Buffett wants to cash out on his real estate at his home and then put that, place it back into the equities market, all right? And I believe that's what he's currently actually doing right now. Okay, think about that for a second, okay? So I thought it was a really interesting position that he's taking, okay? And so start searching that, right? Like stock market, right? Start searching that in the time frame. You'll see who you should listen to. Now, final thing as I wrap this up, okay? I got a text message from a young guy and makes great money in the space of real estate. He is an investor himself. He's a real estate agent himself. And he's currently involved in a out-of-state property that he actually fixed up. And he currently has it for sale and he currently has it for rent. He said that he has two applicants at $1,100 and he can possibly sell it now and then maybe make around $30,000. And the question says, what would Jeff Koga do knowing that? And my response was, I said, hey, you know what? If you can get anywhere between 5 to 7 times your net cash flow, then you may want to sell. I said may, but preferably you want to shoot for maybe 10, right? 10-year cash flow income that you can get on one shot, then it might make sense to sell. Now, when you start running his numbers on it, right, he falls under like 4 years or something like that. And because of that, I was just like, nah, I wouldn't sell. I would just hold on to it for cash flow purposes, all right? And the reason why I told him that is because he has a good chunk of cash, maybe anywhere between 185,000. I think he has like 185. He said that if he sells it, his cash is gonna be 225,000 in cash that he's gonna have. Now, keep in mind, he's 27 years old, okay? 27 years old, and he can have that type of cash. And he owns a house himself, and he rents it out, and his roommates or whatever covers the mortgage, and pretty much he lives for free, right? So he's really, really smart and savvy. So he said, what would you do? And I said, man, I would just hold on to it, you know, have that property free and clear, take the cash flow of that $750 a month or so and apply it towards your current home and accelerate your mortgage to pay it off. Right, that's what I said, pay it off, because that's gonna be a lot better for you, so that way now you have assets. And then if you need access to capital because there's opportunities to buy into the equities market or buy into more real estate, then guess what? Make sure you have a home equity line of credit against that property so you have the ability to withdraw money instantly from there. All right, and this is where you want to be really strategic on your financial future, because when you understand these kind of stuff, especially if you're a millennial, right, as you're going through this, regardless of where you're at, if you don't have any money, you have some money, you have a little cash, you have some, all right, you want to start playing chess moves, okay, not checkers, because again, this is a lifelong journey. And me, for one, I played checkers in my early days and I'm paying for it still to this day, because I don't have a ginormous asset base that if I knew better and know the things now, I would be in a dramatically different position right now. So again, I'm building it back up, but luckily enough, I have multiple streams of income from my intellectual capital that I gain that I do really well in, okay? So that's my recommendation to you, okay? It's financial literacy is key, ladies and gentlemen, and please understand professional biases. And if you're a millennial gotten this far in watching this, all right, again, pay attention to who you're listening to, and just know that there's opportunities to be made regardless if the market goes up or if the market comes down. But to take advantage of these opportunities, you gotta have knowledge, all right? You gotta have specialized knowledge to be able to take advantage of that. So that's what I got. This is Jeff Koga here on this beautiful Saturday. If you enjoyed any of this, leave a comment below, and I will talk to you then. Take care and bye-bye.